Now it is time to jump into the last message in our series titled, Don't Waste Your Life. And so I need you to look at your neighbor one last time and say, don't waste your life. Don't waste your life. All right. If you haven't caught on yet, you got one more chance here to not waste your life. Okay. So the purpose of this series is really to help you to live a life of purpose in a world full of distractions. The reality is the world we live in is just so full of them, so full of distractions, stuff coming at us all the time. The enemy's constantly wanting to distract us. The world around us is constantly wanting to distract us from our purpose that God has for us. And I honestly believe that you can know your purpose in life. I believe that God has revealed it in his word. And I also believe that you can walk into that purpose. And so this series has been focused on helping you to discern that purpose, that you exist. As we talked about in week one, you are a light. You exist to be a light in a dark world, and that then you want to live out that purpose by using your gifts that God has uniquely given you and using your story, not wasting your story, that we all have a story and a unique story that plays a part of the bigger story, which is the story of Jesus and his redemption of our world. But today we're going to really just jump into an issue, and we're going to cover an issue that I believe has the potential to be one of the greatest threats to you living out your purpose, or it could be one of the greatest assets to you living out your purpose. And it all depends on how you handle this issue. What we're going to be talking about today is something that every single one of us deal with on some level, just about every single day. It's something that consumes our time and our culture and our world, and it's such an important issue. Today we're going to be talking about the subject of money. And so the title today is Don't Waste Your Money. Look at your neighbor and say, don't waste your money. So give some to me. Give some to me. Don't waste your money, better give some to me. Listen, I believe that this is an important, timely message considering what is unfolding in the world around us. So if you haven't paid attention lately, inflation is at a 40-year high. Gas is up 44% from 1 year ago. 44%. Used cars are up 23% from a year ago. The price of meat is up 14% from 1 year ago. Baby food is up 13% from 1 year ago. The stock market is tumbling. Interest rates and mortgage rates are climbing. Home prices and rental rates are at all-time highs. Student loan debt, consumer debt, credit card debt are all at all-time highs. And this is the wealthiest nation in the world. As the great philosopher and theologian and also three-time Grammy Award-winning artist Nelly once pondered, he asked the question, why do I live this way? Hey, it must be the money, right? Isn't that what he said? I'm pretty sure that's maybe not exactly how it sounded, but that's the question that he asked, right? If you don't know, Nelly just performed here in Fort Wayne at the Headwaters Park this week. And as I shared that with our worship and production team before service, one of the Gen Zers said, who's Nelly? What does she sound like? It's a he. It's a rapper from my childhood. So I believe that the Bible offers us a different way forward. The world that we live in, the richest world in the history of, or the richest nation in the history of the world, has still not figured this out. And yet I believe that the Bible has offered us some principles, some truths, some concepts, some beliefs about money, and then some principles about how to handle money that if we would just live them out, they're not new, nothing new under the sun, but if we would just grab a hold of them and then live them out, it could completely change your life and allow you to live a life of purpose. So today we're going to start in Luke chapter 10. If you have your Bibles, I want to encourage you to open them up to Luke chapter 10. We're going to be in two books today, Luke and then in Proverbs. But we're going to start in Luke chapter 16, verse 10. Luke chapter 16, starting at verse 10. These are the words of Jesus. Whoever can be trusted with very little can also be trusted with much. And whoever is dishonest with very little will also be dishonest with much. So if you have not been trustworthy in handling worldly wealth, who will trust you with true riches? And if you have not been trustworthy with someone else's property, who will give you property of your own? No one can serve two masters. Either you will hate one and love the other, or you will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. So before we get to the principles, we have to start with what Jesus is saying here is the root issue when it comes to money. And the root issue is how you view money. And the reality is for many of us in this room and most of us in the world that we live in today, money has become a master. Money has become an idol. Money has become a god to us. And Jesus says, you cannot serve two masters. You will love one and hate the other. You will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. You can't serve both God and money. So if money is your master, then you can't serve God is what the scripture is saying here. And the reality is many of us in here, we spend our lives serving money, allowing money to be our master, and yet at the same time struggling to find our purpose and live out our purpose. And maybe we've even discovered our purpose, but money has such a control on us, such a handle on us that we fail to actually step into the purpose that God has for us. It's because money has become a master. And the reality is no matter how much you have or no matter how little you have, money can be a master in your life. And so this is not just a message for rich people. This is not just a message for people with a lot of wealth. This is not just a message for poor people or for people who've blown all their money or people who waste all their money. This is a message for all of us. If you've ever held a dollar in your hand, you are responsible to be a wise steward of that dollar. This is a message for every single one of us. And for many of us, we will waste our lives serving money and miss out on the purpose that God has for us. Because money has become our master. So the question is, well, then how would you know? How would you know if money has become a master in your life? And I brought some more props along with me today to help us unpack that and illustrate this. And so there are kind of two ways that I have commonly seen people live out this reality of money being a master in their life. And they're kind of one of two extremes. And a lot of times what happens is you end up in one extreme and then you think people that are in the other extreme are the ones who are allowing money to be their master. But the reality is both of them end up being a master over your life. So the first one is this. It's people who treat money as if it were trash. They waste it. And all of us in here, let's be honest, we've all been guilty of wasting money at some point in our lives. Every single one of us have wasted money, maybe a little bit, some of us maybe a lot, but all of us have wasted some money. And so here are just some examples. I did bring a wad of cash with me today, but this has to go back in the bank. So please do not try to take this money after service, all right? This is going to go back. But one of the ways that people will often waste money, and I'm going to push a little bit, I'm going to step on a few toes, but maybe for some of you, every time you get a paycheck, one of the simple ways that you waste money is you just go and you buy a couple of lottery tickets, right? You just throw a little bit in there, just hoping, just buying a couple. Can I just tell you right now, like you're throwing money away. You are completely throwing money away. I have a family member who every year for Christmas buys me $20 worth of scratch-off tickets. And every year, I end up winning about $3 worth of winnings from those $20 of scratch-off tickets. And every year, I say, can you please just give me a 20? Like, I just want the 20. Please, stop wasting your money. Maybe some of you are going, no, I'm some of the young people especially, like, I'm above that. But there's a modern-day version of this. It's called DraftKings or FanDuel. And every time there's a sporting event, you're wasting your money. You are throwing your money away. Okay, so maybe I'm touching on a few more people here, or maybe some of you, but once a year, there's this pattern that you find yourself in where every year you waste money at this exact same time. It's every year in January, and you sign up for that gym membership, and you just throwing money in there. And the reality is here we are in May, you haven't been to the gym since January, and you still paid for February, March, April, and May. You are throwing money away. You're wasting money. For some of us, maybe it's that Starbucks drive-through that we just hit, you know, every time we go past it, we got to stop in and get that Starbucks fix. Throwing money away. Listen, I'm guilty. They know me by name at Starbucks. They know me by first name. It's almost embarrassing how well they know me over there. I'm guilty. Or for some of us in here, you ever feel like you can't help but throw money away? Anybody else Anybody else in this stage of life where you've got a five-year-old or somewhere around that age that every time you make dinner and then you put it in front of them, you're like, oh, that's just going right in the trash. I've got a kid who doesn't matter. Like yesterday, he could have liked that same exact thing. We put it in front of him today. He does not like it. Sometimes I tell my wife, like, I think it would be easier if we just took it out of the cabinet or the fridge and just right to the trash. Just bypass the kitchen table altogether. He's not going to eat it. Just throw it away. I remember when my daughter, I've told this story before, but one time we were driving home from Illinois, visiting my wife's family, driving back to Fort Wayne, and we stopped at a pizza place on the way. And we actually tried to save time by stopping and by ordering ahead of time. So we stop and we order ahead of time, and I specifically ordered the exact kind of pizza that my daughter liked. She was around that same age, 5-6 years old at the time, and very picky. And so we go in and we sit down, the pizza's ready, and we're trying to make good time to get back at a reasonable hour. And we sit down and she just won't eat the pizza. No matter what we do, we're like, keep trying to convince her, just take a bite, it's your favorite kind of pizza, just eat the pizza. And she's getting more and more upset. And at one point, she's just having this all-out meltdown. So finally, I pull her out and I go to the front of the restaurant and I just try to have this conversation. I'm like, sweetie, what is wrong? Why won't you eat the pizza? This is the exact kind of pizza that you love. And she goes, no, it's the wrong kind. I said, what do you mean it's the wrong kind? This is the same kind of pizza you always eat. She goes, no, it's because they're squares and I like triangles. just throwing money away. Just throwing it away. So I know I made fun of some of the young people earlier for not knowing who Nelly is, but for some of the older people in here, another way that young people like to throw money away, there's this thing called NFTs. Anybody ever heard of an NFT? I don't even know what it means. I just know it just means you're throwing money away. You are throwing money away. You can buy something digital. It's a non-fungible token. Is that right? Did I get that right? Okay. Something digital that says you own it, even though it's not a real thing. It doesn't even exist. You own a picture of something. You pay like thousands of dollars for it. Just throwing money away. So that's one way that we do it, is we waste our money. Another way, though, on the other end of the spectrum, so one end you got people who just throw money, and we're all guilty of it. We're all guilty of it. On the other end of the spectrum, you got people who they hoard their money and they treat it like treasure. And so anytime you get money, you know, you're not afraid to hold on to it, but like you put it in there and you just lock it up. And no matter what happens, this stays with you. And no matter how much you get, it's never enough, and you're always looking to accumulate more and more and more so that you can stockpile it and just hold on to it, and you never spend it, and some people may consider you greedy, and then other times there may be needs that are presented, and you're like, you know what, I know there's a need there, but I worked really hard for this. I strived. I put my blood, sweat, and tears into that to earn those dollars, and so I'm going to hold on to this for dear life. Some of you maybe you would even say, you know what, like I see that there are needs within the church, and I understand that the only way the church operates, the only way the church can function is if the body of Christ actually gives to it. But you know what, like people don't understand how hard I've worked for this. So this, I'm going to hold on to it. I'm going to keep it. Maybe others of you say, you know, I know my neighbor has a need, or somebody in my small group, they're struggling. Somebody else can meet that need because I got to hold on. Like, this is really important to me. So money becomes a treasure to you. You're not throwing it away. You're not treating it like trash, but actually you've gone to the other extreme and you're treating it like treasure. And what I would argue is that in either situation, money has become your master. In either one of these situations, money has become your master. It has so much control over your life and so much control over your purpose that you can't actually live into the purpose that God has called you to. And what often happens is people who treat money like treasure, and they have a whole lot of it, and they've been holding on to it, and they've been stockpiling, they've been saving, and they're not going to spend it, and they're not going to give it, and they're not going to bless other people with it. They're just going to hold on to it for dear life. They've got way more than they'll ever need. They look at people over here, and they say, those are the people who have made money their master. Because they look at somebody over here and they say that money's got complete control over them. Like every time they get money, they just blow it. Every time they get money, they just waste it. They don't know how to be responsible stewards. They're just throwing money away. So why in the world, if I've worked really hard for my money, why in the world would I ever step in and help meet a need of somebody over here who's just blowing their money and wasting it? Because money's their master. And then you have people over here, and they're going, man, like, I know I can waste money sometimes. I know like I can struggle sometimes to be responsible. But gosh, man, like I see somebody over here, and they've just got so much money. They got so much wealth. And it's always easy when you're in this spot to look and find somebody who's got more money than you and go, those are the people who've made money their master. Because money controls them. They're not generous. At least I'm willing to give a few bucks here or there. But these are the people that have made money their master. When in reality, the truth is both extremes, money has become your master. And I believe that Jesus actually presents a different option here and that we can pull it right out of the text. When Jesus offers us this third option, this different way, essentially what Jesus is saying is that money should never be treated as trash that you waste and throw away. It also shouldn't be treated as treasure that you hoard and save and hold on to for your dear life. Instead, money should simply be a tool. Jesus says money should be a tool. It's a tool to be used. He's provided this money for you as a tool to be used, not to be wasted and thrown away, but also not to be hoarded. Here's what I love about a toolbox. Anybody here own a toolbox? How many of you own a toolbox? Okay, people who didn't raise your hands, look around. Those are the people that are going to help you out when you get in a bind. Here's what I love about a toolbox. A toolbox is not something that you stow away and that you got to keep pristine. And that you make sure nothing ever, you know, bumps up against it or bangs up against it. Toolboxes are meant to be a little messy. Toolboxes are meant to be used. I don't know anybody who owns a toolbox and doesn't use that toolbox unless they don't actually know how to use the tools in the toolbox. But if you own the toolbox and you own the tools in the toolbox, you use them. That's the purpose of them. And you're not afraid to use them. You're not afraid to get a little dirty from time to time. You're not afraid to get a little messy from time to time because the purpose of the tool is for you to use it. Now, at the same time, when you have tools and you open up your toolbox, you don't just take the tools out and go throw them away. But you also don't lock them away and never use them. Otherwise, it doesn't serve its purpose. The purpose of the toolbox is so that when God provides, you say, you know what, yeah, you know what, God, I'm going to put these resources that you've given me in my toolbox. And there are some places in the toolbox that maybe I need to stash some little bit away and save and prepare for something that may come along down the road. And there are other places in the toolbox where I just need to make sure that I'm being responsible and the resources are ready because I know they're going to come in and they're going to go out. And then maybe there are even some other places that need to be these easy to access places so that when a need arises, I'm just prepared and I can meet those needs. And if we would treat money like a tool in the toolbox that God has given us, rather than treating it like trash or like treasure, then money no longer becomes a master for us. It becomes a servant. It serves the purpose that God has for us. And what Jesus is arguing here is that money should be a servant and not a master. Money is a terrific servant and a terrible master. It is a terrible treasure, but a wonderful tool. That's what Jesus is telling us here. And so I just want to unpack with you for the remainder of our time how we can actually use money as a tool that God has provided for us rather than throwing it away and being wasteful with it or hoarding it and treating it like treasure. And these principles that I'm going to walk through, these aren't new. I've actually preached a similar message to this in the past. And the reality is, what I'm going to share with you, even for those of the youngest in the room, maybe some elementary kids, some middle school kids who are in the room here today, you're going to be able to understand these principles. That's the easy part. You probably already know them. That's the easy part. The hard part is actually applying them and living them out and sticking to them. And all of them, every single one of these principles, they're ancient. They come from the book of Proverbs. They're thousands of years old. Thousands of years old, and yet because the Word of God is living and active, you're going to see just how applicable they are to your life in this moment in the 21st century today. The Word of God is still speaking if we would just listen and obey. and allow his word to shape our lives. This could change your life forever, and specifically when it comes to living out your purpose. There are four principles I want to unpack with you with the remainder of our time. Number one is this: you've got to prioritize your provision. Prioritize your provision. So Proverbs verse 24, chapter 24, verse 27 says this: put your outdoor work in order and get your fields ready. After that, build your house. Put your outdoor work in order and get your fields ready. After that, build your house. Prioritize your provision. I want to encourage you to write these down. Write both the principle down and the scripture down so that you can come back to this and apply it later. But you've got to prioritize your provision. Modern day translation of this proverb would be this: get a job, pay your bills, feed your family, and then after that, use the rest of your resources on your other wants and needs. It says get your outdoor work in order, get your fields ready, and after that, build your house. That means you've got to prioritize your provision, including your paycheck, including everything that God provides for you. It's your job to prioritize it in a way that is being a responsible steward. That means you've got to put your needs before your wants. And sometimes we make all sorts of justifications to say that our wants are actually needs. And then we spend money on our wants trying to pretend like they're needs, and we don't have any money left to actually take care of the real needs. So let me give you just a couple examples of this. You want a new car. Somebody's going, no, I need a new car. No, no, no. You want a new car. You need reliable transportation. You need reliable transportation. You don't need a new car. You may want a new car. And I'm not saying that it's always wrong to buy a new car. But if your financial house isn't in order, then you don't need a new car. And actually, you'll never need a new car. Newsflash, I'm 34 years old. I've been driving since I was 16. Never owned a new car, and I'm doing okay. Now, there's a reality that comes along with that, including literally right now, one of our two vehicles is in the shop. And so we're down to one car because it's a used car and it has to get worked on from time to time. That's inconvenient, isn't it? But it's not a need, it's a want. It's a want. So you've got to prioritize your needs first and your wants second. Another example would be this: you want a nice house. Some people are saying, no, you don't understand. I need, like, our family's grown. I need a nice house. Like, we've been living in this. No, you need a roof over your head. You may want a nice house. And listen, I get it. Okay, my wife and I, we love our home. Love our home. We live right here in the neighborhood. We love our home. But one thing we don't love about it is that it is over 100 years old. And when you own a home that's over 100 years old, there is always something falling apart on that house. And there have been times where we have had this conversation about, you know what, it would be really nice if we could just, maybe we could sell our house and go find something a little nicer, a little newer, a little less headaches. Every year in the winter, we come in this little side door right off our driveway. And when you come in, there's this tiny little spot where the half staircase goes down to the basement. The other half goes up to the kitchen. And we're all cramming in there. Now we got five of us, my wife and three kids, one of them in a car seat, trying to squeeze in, trying to get snow off. And we're all squeezing in this little tiny spot, this 100-year-old home where the hallways are short, the walkways are narrow. And in those moments, I go, man, it'd be really nice to have a new house. That's a want, not a need. We have all of our needs completely met. And so you've got to put your outdoor work in order and get your fields ready. After that, build your house. You know what that means? Some of you may need to live in a tent for a little while. I'm talking metaphorically here, but I mean, like, that's kind of a new thing now. People are going off the grid and living in tents. That's fine, like, if that's what the Lord calls you to. But, like, metaphorically, some of you may need to live in a tent for a little while so that you can get your you know what the outdoor work is and the fields are? That's provision. This is an agricultural society here, so we're talking about God's provision. Make sure that your provision is taken care of. Do the right things first, and then after that, you can build your house. God's not saying he's going to say no to every want that you ever have in life. He's just saying there's a proper order here. So one of the rules that I live by, I've shared this with you many times, but I'm going to remind you again. It's a really simple rule. Man, it's a game changer. It's hard to do, simple to understand, but it is a game changer for your life. It's the 10-10-80 rule. And here's what that is. You give the first 10%, you save the next 10%, and then you live off of the next 80%. I'm going to say it one more time. Give the first 10%. That's really important. The order here matters. Give the first 10%. Save the next 10% and live off of the next 80%. And I think for a lot of people, they love that idea. They love that principle. They love that rule. They say, man, that sounds great, but I'm just going to go in reverse order. I'm just going to go in reverse order, and so I'm going to live off that 80%. Then, you know, I'll save that 10%, and then I'll give that last 10%. And what ends up happening is that 80% quickly turns into 85%, then 90%, then 95%, then 100%, then 110%, and then, uh-oh, I'm in debt. I spent more than I had, and I didn't save a dime. I didn't give to anything. There were some specific things that I know God was calling me to give to, and I didn't even have the resources, the dollars to do it. So it's important, the order here, 10, 10, 80. Giving that first 10%, saving that next 10%, and then living off of the 80%. Now, for some people here, you're sitting here and you're thinking to yourself, like that, there is no way. I know my financial picture right now. There is no possible way that I could live. I'm living off of 100+% of my resources right now. 100+% of my provision that God's provided for me right now. You know what this means? It means you got to make some changes. It means you got to make some changes to your lifestyle. If you want to live a life of purpose that God has called you to live, then you've got to make some changes to the way you're living now so that you can step into that. And so I just want to challenge you. Like, just give it a try. Make a budget. And imagine if you were to actually give that first 10% and then save that next 10%. What it would take for you to live off of that next 80%. There are some people who are now going, I think we are actually going to live in a tent. I think that's what's going to happen. We're going to live in a tent for a period of time. And now, before I go any further, let me just say, like, this isn't a message about giving money to the church. It's not. We've already received our offering. We never pass a basket, never pass a bucket. There's a giving box in the back. That's the only way that you can give here is online or through that giving box. We don't guilt anybody into giving. And if you're somebody who says, you know what, I'm not sure of what I believe about the church and I'm still on this journey trying to figure out Jesus, fine. Like, I'm not saying you give it to the church. I believe in the principle of the tithe and giving to the church. I believe in that wholeheartedly. And I think there are a lot of people who've maybe been growing in that maturity in your faith who would say, absolutely, you believe in that. But if you're somebody who's new to the faith, you don't have to give it to the church. Just try the principle. Find some important things that matter to you, the important causes, and bless other people, bless other ministries, bless other organizations, but try the principle out and see what happens. But you've got to prioritize your provision. Either you're going to tell your money where to go or your money's going to tell you where it went. Those are the only two choices. Those are the only two options. Number two is this. Pay off debt aggressively. Pay off debt aggressively. Student loan debt, consumer debt, mortgage debt. It's all at an all-time high right now. So much debt. The average household has $158,000 in total debt in the richest nation in the world. And so I understand that we live in a world that just runs off of debt, thrives off of it. That's the system we're in. I'm here to tell you, you don't have to play the game. And I also know that we live in a world that we have just, all of us, can we just recognize for a second that we've been so coddled when it comes to the concept of instant gratification? Like, we've just been so coddled with this idea that like you just, whatever you want, whenever you want it, you deserve it, even if you don't have the dollars for it. And so just, here's another credit card. Just swipe it because you deserve it. So go ahead and get that next thing, even though you don't have the money for it. I recognize that. This is an area where, listen, believers, followers of Jesus, we've got to build up some spiritual discipline here to pay off debt aggressively. Debt is such an enemy to living a life of purpose. It is such an enemy. The text says this, Proverbs 22:7, the rich rule over the poor and the borrower is slave to the lender. The borrower is slave to the lender. That's the world that we live in. And we're just so used to it that we've gotten comfortable. We've gotten comfortable just being enslaved to the lender. People just say, oh, you know, it's okay. You're going to have debt all your life. Why? Why do you have to have debt all your life? You don't have to have debt all your life. I understand that most people are going to have debt all their life. Let's not be like most people. Let's choose a different way, a different path here. The borrower is slave to the lender, and so that will continually consume your focus, your energy, your time, and your effort, and it will keep you from living into God's purpose. The beauty of being free of debt is that you're free. You're free. You don't owe anybody anything. You're free. And so here are just some simple, again, simple concepts, hard to do, hard to live out, easy to understand. If you want to get out of debt and you want to do it aggressively, here are just some simple things you can do. Number one, cut up the credit cards. Somebody right now is going, oh, yeah. See, you don't understand. I got some points. And when you get 7 million points, you get $5 off your next flight. Congratulations. Go get your points. There was this TV show. I'm not sure it's appropriate to quote it in church, but it was this show called Whose Line Is It Anyway? And the whole purpose of the show was that the points don't matter, okay? And that's the same thing when it comes to your credit card. The points don't matter. Now, there may be a couple of people in here who you've mastered the game, you figured it out, and you're earning all these rewards from the points. Here's a basic rule to live by. If you have carried a balance and haven't paid off in full every single month your credit card for the last 12 months, then cut up your credit cards because you're going to lose the game. You think you're winning the game. Listen, the credit card companies are some of the most profitable companies in the world for a reason. They're smarter than you. I know that's really hard to understand, but that you're not going to outsmart them. They're smarter than you are. And they know how to work it in, and they know how to get you to spend beyond your means. And can I just explain to you in the simplest form what you're doing? When you spend money on credit that you don't have, you are borrowing from your own future. It's like you're looking down the road 6 months from now and saying, I'm just going to take a couple $100 out of that paycheck right now, and then the next one out of that paycheck right now. You are borrowing from your own future. So cut up the credit cards. Maybe sell the car. Used car sales are up 23%. This is a good time to sell a car. I'm just saying, it's a good time to sell one. If you've got a high car payment on a car right now, maybe now is the best time to go sell that car. Make a budget. Stick to the budget. What that means is, like, don't spend more than you make. Again, crazy, crazy concepts here. Maybe it's time for you to cancel that gym subscription that we talked about earlier, the money you've just been throwing away. Time to cancel that subscription. But whatever it takes, stop. Just also stop buying stuff that you don't need. Like, if you're in debt, stop buying stuff you don't need. You got to prioritize this. That's what it means to get out of debt aggressively. The world's going to tell you, get out of debt as passively as you possibly can. What Scripture is saying is, no, you got to get out of debt aggressively. And so all of us, how many of you, I'm just curious, how many of you are willing to admit that at some point in your life, you made a purchase of something that you thought was really valuable, really important, you're going to use it a lot, and then you've never actually used it at all? Okay, so most of you, the rest of you, next Sunday, we're going to be talking about what it means to be honest in church, okay? That's the message for next week. I've done this. A few years ago, I got into triathlons. That was my new thing. I was really into triathlons. And so I did a couple of triathlons, and then I convinced my wife, here I am, this rookie triathlete, like not winning anything. No, not like very much middle of the pack in this sport. And I convinced my wife, I absolutely have to have a wetsuit. Like, this is critical. It's going to, you know, make a significant improvement, and I'm going to use this thing all the time. I used it one time. One time. I know I paid more than 100, probably less than $300, somewhere in the middle there for that stupid thing, and it's hanging in my closet right now. It is a very dry wetsuit. And it's going to probably get sold in a garage sale here in a few weeks. All of us have done that, so stop buying stuff that you don't need. Additionally, get a side hustle. Listen, it's never been easier, in the history of humanity for people to get a side hustle. Here's just maybe another good rule of thumb. If you've got a high car payment and until you pay that car off, you should probably be Ubering people and putting all the money that you make from Uber to paying that car off. Create some challenges for yourself to get out of debt aggressively. Whatever it is, you've got to be aggressive with it. And look, that's going to look different in every season of life. But I'm just going to share one more story with you before I move on, because I want you to know I'm living this stuff out. Like, I'm living this stuff out. This is a rule. This is a principle my wife and I have been adhering to for years. And so whenever my wife works and we have two incomes, we can be more aggressive at paying off debt. And then whenever she doesn't work, we have to back that down a little bit, but we're still as aggressive as we possibly can be. And so the only debt that we've ever carried, because when I met my wife and when we got married, she told me, she said, having a credit card is a deal breaker. And I just liked her more than I like credit cards, so I've never had one. So women, maybe like that's just, when you walk out of church today, like that's the conversation you have with your husband. Like, listen, get rid of the credit card if you want to keep me. And husbands, get rid of the credit card. I'm going to get somebody in trouble. Somebody's going to be in a big fight today. Somebody's going to be in a big fight. I'm going to get some emails this week. We're in pastoral counseling. So we've never carried any debt other than our mortgage and our student loans. We never carried a car payment debt. We just don't do it. We buy used cars. We pay cash for them. And so we've had these student loans, and we both graduated from private Christian college, very expensive. And so we had these pretty significant student loans, and we've been as aggressive as we can over the years trying to pay those off. And then about a month ago, even though she's not working right now, we're still saving and putting money aside in different categories, different buckets for different things. And we looked at our student loan balance, and the student loan balance was about the same as this pretty large bucket of money we had over in this other category. And at the same time, I was trying to convince my wife to let me take money out of that bucket and go invest it in something that would have been so stupid. Like, it would have never been a return on it. It was like dumber than an NFT. Okay, too far? Okay, too far. All right. But I was trying to talk her into that, and she was trying to talk me, and she's like, no, I've been wanting a new kitchen since we bought this house. I really would love to spend that money on the kitchen. And as we were talking about it and trying to be wise stewards, we just kind of looked and we realized, like, no, like, we're going to live this out. And so we paid off the balance of our student loans. We don't have a single student loan left. So the only debt we have left is a mortgage, and now we can be more aggressive on that. And by our mid-40s, we will be mortgage debt-free if we just stay the course without being a whole lot more aggressive than we are right now. And listen, like, you can be debt-free. You can do it. Like, you don't have to carry debt your whole life. You just have to be aggressive, and you have to resist the direction of the culture and go in a different way. Pay off debt aggressively. Number three, plan for the future. Plan for the future. Proverbs 21:20 says this. The wise store up choice food and olive oil, but fools gulp theirs down. The wise store up choice food and olive oil, but fools gulp theirs down. It is wise and biblical to plan and prepare for the future. It is a wise and biblical thing to do. Now, this isn't where we put all of our hope, all right? So it doesn't become our treasure. Doesn't become our treasure where we're just going to stockpile as much as we possibly can, way more than we'll ever need, and we'll hold on to it as much as we can, and we're never going to be willing to be generous whatsoever. But it is wise and biblical to maybe have an area in the toolbox that we're saying, you know what, no, we're saving and we're planning. There's a purpose for those dollars. But it is wise and biblical to prepare and plan for the future. There is a myth that having less money somehow makes you more godly. So I'm just going to bust that myth right now. Having less money doesn't make you more godly. Having more money doesn't make you more godly. That's another myth, right? This prosperity gospel that, like, if you're actually more godly, he's just going to give you more and more money. No, Jesus makes you more godly, period. Jesus makes you more godly. No matter how much money you have or don't have, Jesus is what makes you more godly. Christ and Christ alone. And his refining work in your heart. Money is simply a magnifier of what's already in your heart. So the more money you have, the bigger the magnifier glass gets. It's just going to reveal what's already in your heart. And so it is wise and biblical for us to plan and prepare for the future. Please do not use the Bible to justify spending all of your money, throwing away all of your money, and taking on all kinds of debt and say, you know what, I'm doing that because I'm trying to be biblical. No, that's foolish. That's what the text actually says. Fools gulp theirs down. Fools gulp theirs down. The wise store up choice food and olive oil, but fools gulp theirs down. So, back to this rule. It's called the 10-10-80 rule. Trying to make sure you're catching on. Give the first 10%. Save the next 10%. It's not give and then live and then hopefully there's a little bit extra to save. It's give, save, and then live. So you're giving the first 10% and you're saving the next 10%. And that means, yes, you got to learn to live on 80% of whatever provision God has given you. It's going to take a shift. It's going to take a change. It's doable. It's possible. My wife and I do it, and I know many other people who are living this way as well. You need to save for the future. For some people in here, that may mean saving for retirement and investing in that way. For other people, it may mean saving for your kids' college. And for many of us and all of us here, it means saving for unexpected expenses. They will happen. The car is going to break down. The idea that you're just going to live on a wing and a prayer and hope that the car that you bought will never have any issues, I'm sorry, it's not going to happen. The car is going to have issues. If you live in a 100-year-old home like me, we've got a plan for the unexpected. So you need to plan for that and prepare for that and have a budget and set aside money in those different categories so that when that stuff happens, your whole financial house doesn't get flipped upside down. But instead, it's no fun to spend the money on the car repair, but it's more fun than not having the money that you need to spend on the car repair. So I just want to encourage you, save for the future. It is wise, it is biblical to plan for the future. And so just write that, if you don't get anything else, write that 10-10-80 rule down and then live it out. And then finally, number four, posture your hands openly. Posture your hands openly. Proverbs 11, verses 24 and 25 says this. One person gives freely, yet gains even more. Another withholds unduly, but comes to poverty. A generous person will prosper. Whoever refreshes others will be refreshed. Did you catch that? One person gives freely, yet gains even more. Another one withholds unduly, yet comes to poverty. A generous person will prosper. Whoever refreshes others will be refreshed. This is kingdom economics that we're talking about here. Kingdom economics doesn't work the way the world works. And honestly, the way the world works doesn't work. So I would just encourage you, like, if you find yourself in that mess that I read off at the very beginning of this message, maybe try a different kind of economics. Try kingdom economics, where you say, you know, no, I'm going to posture my hands openly. And what that means is that everything that you have doesn't actually belong to you. We just sang it today. I give you everything. All my life is yours. And one of the hardest areas for us to actually live that out is when it comes to our money. And so I just want to encourage you, like, it's not wrong for you to have money. I'm not against people having money. I actually think that it can be a really incredible tool to help you accomplish God's purpose for your life. But the key here, when it comes to that actually being a functional tool, is for you to posture your hands openly and say, all of this belongs to God. Not just 10% of it, not just 20% of it, 100% of it belongs to God. Everything that I have, all the money that I have, all the resources that I have, all the assets that I have, it all belongs to God. And therefore, my hands are open, meaning I can receive whatever God may want to give me, but also that means that I'm willing to give whatever he may lead me to give. I'm prepared for it. I've planned for it. I'm ready for it. God has done the hard work in me for it. See, I think the reality is many of us, we want God to give us more, and we even say things like, man, if I could just have a little bit more money, it would fix all my problems. And I'll go ahead and quote one more famous theologian, the notorious B.I.G., who said, more money, more problems. I'm pretty sure he didn't say it exactly like that either. I'm still working on my rap game. But the reality is, until you understand the principles and you understand God's heart for money, the more money you have, it won't help you. It'll actually hurt you. But if instead you can say, regardless of how much money I have or don't have, I'm going to start right now with the resources that have been entrusted to me. I'm going to be a good steward with those resources. Let me go back to the beginning text. Whoever can be trusted with very little can also be trusted with much. See, I think there are a lot of people who are thinking, you know what, like, sure, I can't be trusted, but I don't have very much right now. If God would actually give me more, then I could be trusted with it. The Word of God says it's the opposite. He says, whoever can be trusted with little can be trusted with much. So what are you doing with what you have right now? Are you being faithful and obedient to God's principles with the resources that he's entrusted you with right now? And if you're not, then I'm sorry, like, you are a fool to think that he's going to entrust you with more. But on the other hand, if you would be faithful with what he has provided for you, even if you have less, you're still going to be a good steward. And you're still going to live into the purpose that God has for your life. And he goes on to say, so if you have not been trustworthy in handling worldly wealth, who will trust you with true riches? And if you have not been trustworthy with someone else's property, who will give you property of your own? Can I remind you, like, this world is not your home. Like, you are here for a very short time, brothers and sisters. And then comes eternity. And everything you have right now is not your own. It's somebody else's property. And he's asking right now, are you willing to be a good steward with what I've trusted you right now? Because this belongs to somebody else. You're the steward, not the owner. And you exist to serve God and not money. So I just want to challenge you, like, posture your hands openly. Position yourself in a way so that you can posture your hands openly. And then trust God with the results. Again, I know it sounds crazy. I know it sounds impossible, but this is kingdom economics. One person gives freely, yet gains even more. Another withholds unduly, but comes to poverty. A generous person will prosper. Whoever refreshes others will be refreshed. That's kingdom economics. It's not about waiting until you have more. If you're waiting until you have more to become generous, you'll never be generous. I'm telling you that right now. You will never, ever be generous. And here's how you know that. Because you can look back at a time in your life where you had less and you said, when I get more, then I'll be generous. And if you're still not doing it, you'll never do it. You'll never do it. Because there will never be enough. There will always be a desire for more. Money will always be your master. The greatest way for money to not be your master is, and for it to turn into a servant, is to become generous. To posture your hands openly. Say, like, none of this belongs to me. It's all God. So I'm just going to give as he calls me to give. And I'm going to be faithful to what he's called me to do. And then you get to live into your purpose. It becomes one of the most powerful tools for you to accomplish the purpose that God has in your life. One of the most powerful tools. So I know you've heard me say this before, but I'm going to say it again. Rich people aren't generous. Poor people aren't generous. Generous people are generous. Generous people are generous. So start today. Start today with whatever you have. Be faithful with whatever he has entrusted you. Whoever can be faithful with a little can be trusted with much. Be faithful with whatever he has entrusted you. Prioritize your provision, pay off debt aggressively, plan for the future, and then posture your hands openly. And if you do those things, again, these aren't new. They're ancient. They're game changers. They're completely different than the way the world we live in operates. But if you do these things, I'm here to tell you, it will change your life and you will live into your purpose. Let me pray for you. I'm going to invite our prayer team down front at this time as well. Heavenly Father, we just thank you. We thank you for your word. We thank you that you have sent us your Holy Spirit who is with us now. And Holy Spirit, we just thank you that you have illuminated your word here today to our hearts and minds. We thank you for the words of Jesus, who is the living word, who has taught us this convicting truth that we can't serve two masters. And so God, I pray that for every single one of us in here, you would convict us of where money has become an idol, where it has become a treasure, where it has become a god in our life. And Lord, help us instead to treat money as a tool, to be used for your kingdom and for your purpose. And God, I pray for any person who is in this place today who feels just so overwhelmed, feels so burdened by their financial picture and the situation they're in. I pray, Lord, that you would just empower them by your Holy Spirit to get started, not to be in fear, but to just take one step at a time. And God, I just thank you in advance for the miracle stories and testimonies that will come out of this message. I know every time I've shared a message like this, I thank you that there's always been, sometimes days later, sometimes weeks later, sometimes months later, and sometimes years later, testimonies of people sharing how they have taken your principles from your word and applied it to their financial situation, and it has changed their life. So God, I just pray that would be true for the people of this church body today. Have your way as we go from this place. We love you, we trust you, and pray this all in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen.